concept of the journey was quite simple, to sail around the world. But there was only one catch. I didn't have a sailboat. I don't think technicalities like that should ever stop you from moving forward in life. Why not just hitchhike? And while the idea of someone standing at the end of the pier sticking their thumb out to the open ocean seems a little far-fetched, that's pretty much what happened. A year and a half earlier, I had moved to Kingston to train for the journey, first crewing on raceboats around town, and by the end of the season taken under the wing of the local chandlery to learn anything and everything boat-related, and most importantly, the lingo. I quickly observed from the sailing community that sailing knowledge often comes second to sailing vocabulary. As the winter approached and the water began to freeze over, I decided the time had come to pack up and hit the high seas. Securing the first ride was simple. There are websites which connect potential crew with boat owners, and with a very loose agreement to meet a boat at the edge of the Darien Gap in Panama, I hopped in a plane and flew south. My plan was to sail along the Caribbean coast of Panama in a place called Kuna Yala for a month before transiting the Panama Canal and entering the Pacific Ocean. Since I had never sailed in the ocean before, a 500-mile shakedown cruise sounded like a good idea. Kuna Yala is a thin strip of land in an archipelago of about 360 islands along the coast of the Caribbean Sea. The area is named after the Kuna people who inhabit the area. They aren't native to the region, but instead moved down to the coast from the mountains soon after Europeans arrived to the Americas, and in response to the poor treatment they received from both the Spaniards and warring tribes. Because the mosquitoes on the mainland are so thick, they moved to the islands and now enjoy near complete autonomy from the Panamanian government. To this day, there is only one road into the region, and it only services a very small area. The Kuna live in villages built on a handful of tiny islands. These islands are bursting at the seams with palm frond huts and labyrinths of alleyways between. Their life is very much entwined with the ocean. Many men fish for their income, while others paddle canoes to the mainland to farm. Every Kuna knows how to paddle a canoe, which is called an ulu. Not an easy feat, considering ulus are carved from huge logs and are incredibly heavy and unstable. I was impressed to see Kuna paddlers standing in their ulus, or better, hoisting a sail and jib. I tried to paddle an ulu myself, and spent most of the time clutching onto the gunwales. Their society is matriarchal. In fact, the women are so powerful in Kuna society that if a couple gives birth to only sons, the youngest will be raised female. Quite often, after a marriage, a young man will arrive to his bride's parents' house with nothing but the clothes on his back and his machete. Kuna women are in charge. If a young man doesn't behave, he might find himself sleeping with the dogs. Disputes in the village are settled each night in the central hut, or congreso, overlooked by the village chief, called the sila. Entire village attendance is mandatory. The village will vote on a resolution, and there are no appeals. To the delight of the crowd, a young man can state his case and either be redeemed or spectacularly embarrassed. In Kuna Yala, men tend to find it easier just to keep their mouths shut. Kuna women tend to the village and their families, but also spend a fair amount of time producing molas. The mola is the definitive symbol for the Kuna people. Brightly colored, often psychedelically patterned embroideries form the breastplate of their traditional dress. The mola has become an unexpectedly popular item to trade with passing sailboats, thus cementing the women's power in the village even further. You may have thought you dropped your anchor in a secluded, uninhabited bay, but within seconds, you will hear happy chatter and the sounds of paddles thumping the sides of an ulu. The Kuna women have found you. They're waving their molas, and resistance is futile. In Kuna Yala, the coconut is a form of currency. It is the largest export by far. Each year, one island hosts a summit for all the silas, who will paddle in from all corners of Kuna Yala in order to agree upon a new coconut trading price, so that no one village undersells the others. The coconuts are traded for just about anything the village needs from merchant ships arriving from Colombia. However, in the past, the Colombians have raided the islands, stealing coconuts and trafficking cocaine to the mainland. To prevent this, most young married couples are sent off to outer islands to become coconut caretakers, protecting the islands and safeguarding their sovereignty. In the eyes of the sila, however, this is a clever plan. It rids the island of rowdy youngsters, so he can enjoy quieter nights in the Congreso, and dedicate more time to swinging in his hammock. When I reached the Panama Canal, I began to realize that my current ride was not panning out the way I hoped it would. It was at the Panama Canal Yacht Club where I began truly hitchhiking for the first time, and found a ride with a Canadian the same age as myself. We were both relative novices in the world of long-distance ocean sailing, why should that stop us? It would only be a 9-day cruise to the Galapagos. And so we entered the canal and sailed over the continental divide. Very few people can claim this, but the credit is due to engine problems while motoring through Gatun Lake. When the last of the Panama Canal lock walls opened, we could see the waters of the world's largest ocean, the Pacific, waiting patiently ahead. The Pacific Ocean has always been a mythical place for me. In the months before leaving, I had stayed up at night reading stories about cannibals and missionaries, swashbuckling sailors and hula dancers, Polynesian ocean-going canoes and Tongan feasts. My heroes became Captain Cook, Charles Darwin, and Thor Heyerdahl. However, looking at the maps, all I could see was water. Deep down, that's what drew me to this adventure in the first place, the chance to be surrounded by miles and miles of water. How would we adapt? Where would our thoughts take us? The Pacific Ocean was by far the best place to find out. And we were headed to the Galapagos. This passage, my first time overnight at sea, was a mind-blowing experience, for the simple reason of solitude. There were entire days and nights with absolutely nothing to see, nothing to hear, and not a breath of wind. I love answering questions about the trip, but the most common one I hear is, "So, how was it?" I prefer questions that catch me off guard, and prove the person asking is trying to picture it all in their head. Something like, "During an ocean passage, do you anchor at night?" Now, I think that would be a perfectly reasonable question to ask. From the point of view of the person asking, only a fool would go to sea and sail non-stop for weeks on end. But we were fools, and the answer is no. It might have been a recipe for trouble, but we sailed 24 hours a day, settling into a watch schedule. Adjusting to watches is often the toughest part of ocean sailing, but there's something about it that's strangely alluring. It's like joining a secret society of ancient mariners and explorers. But the novelty soon passes. Inexperienced, we settled into an ill-fated watch schedule of 2 hours on, 2 hours off. That way we could suffer from sensory deprivation and sleep deprivation at the same time. Ironically, one of my favorite memories of the entire sailing trip was a night when there was absolutely no wind. We decided to take all the sails down, turn off all the lights, and just drift in whatever direction the current chose to take us. And it was absolutely terrifying. The sensation of vulnerability was overwhelming. We were an invisible speck in the middle of nowhere, hanging above a watery abyss 23,000 feet deep. We could only guess what sea monsters lurked below as we rocked gently back and forth in the swell, the silence broken only by the slapping of our halyards on the mast. But just as I had imagined, the night sky had more stars than I had ever seen before, stretching to the horizon all around us, the sparkling of bioluminescence in the water below, reflections from the stars above, and the otherwise complete pitch darkness all around created the illusion that we were floating in outer space. Being out in the middle of nowhere is a sensation that I never grew tired of throughout the journey, and every time we reached shore, it drew me back. Back at home, it's what I miss the most. After 9 days, we reached the Galapagos, and were instantly greeted by wildlife. During our stay, blue-footed boobies pooped all over the deck, sea lions lounged around in our dinghy, and we chased iguanas up and down the beach with our cameras. The islands are a national park and biological marine reserve, and besides traffic from sailing yachts, the tourism here is tightly regulated, and everyone wants a piece of the pie. We encountered corruption at virtually every level of government that we encountered. My best travel advice that I can provide is if you pay a fee to anyone in a uniform, do not ask for a receipt. We began preparing for the next journey, which would be the big one. It was the passage to the most remote island chain in the world, the Marquesas of French Polynesia.